So I hope we can start the class. One second, Mike. One second. Can you see the slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So last class we have covered block one, Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. So in block two, we'll discuss about the poems of Edmund Spenser. So Chaucer's period was from 1340 to 1400, and Spenser's period is from 1558 to 1625. So he was the first major English poet of early Elizabethan period. Okay. So after Chaucer's death, that is in 1400, Chaucer died. After Chaucer's death, that was a dormant period. For 100 years, English literature was in a dormant state. So 1558, after the accession of Queen Elizabeth to the throne, starts the Elizabethan period, and it continued till 1625. Okay. Yeah. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So in this section, we will deal with Epithalamian, Prothalamian, and three sonnets from Amerity. So, an Epithalamian. So the poem Epithalamian is dedicated to his wife. It's a special poem written in honor of a marriage. An epithalamium is a song written especially for a bride on her way to marriage chamber. The word epithalamium means bridal song or chamber. Okay. Yeah. Epithalamium is a Greek term. Epi means upon, thalamium means bridal chamber. So Edmund Spenser has written this ode to his wife on their wedding day in 1594. It was first published in 1595 as a part of volume titled Amerity. Let me tell you, Amerity is a love sonnet. A collection of love sonnets. There are 88 sonnets in Amerity. The volume included a sequence of 89 sonnets along with a series of poem called Anacreontics and Epithalamium. So Epithalamium was published along with Amerity and Anacreontics. Okay. Now, structure of Epithalamium. So there are 433 lines in Epithalamium, and there are 24 stanzas. So each stanza represent each hour of a day. There are 24 stanzas in Epithalamium. Each stanza represent each hour of the day. So 24, yeah. And 365, there are 365 longer lines and 68 shorter lines. So 365 longer lines represent every day in a year. Okay. Then the first 16 stanza represent daytime, and the last 8 stanzas represent nighttime. So this is the structure of Epithalamium. Hello. Are you following me? Yeah. Can you see the slide? If it is not possible, please inform me. Okay, I will present it again. Okay, so now can you see a scansion? This is a sonnet written by, yeah, Edmund Spenser. So the rhyming scheme, A-B-A-B, B-C-B-C, C-D-C-D, E-E is Spenserian rhyming scheme. Please note it. Just like Chaucer, our Edmund Spenser has invented his own rhyming scheme, that is ABAB, BCBC, CDCD, DEE is Spenser's rhyming scheme. Okay. And the division goes like this. Yeah, Spenserian sonnet was invented by Edmund Spenser and uses rhyming scheme ABAB, BC, CDCDEE. This is the rhyming scheme. Please note it. So when you're writing an annotation, if you're getting lines from Epithalamium, anyway, Epithalamium have slight variation in the rhyming scheme that I will tell you later. See, whatever poem, if you know the rhyming scheme, it will be better if you can add that in the introduction. So his sonnet consists of three quatrains followed by a heroic couplet. So last class we have seen what an heroic couplet is, isn't it? Heroic couplet. What is a heroic couplet? Last class we have seen that. What is a heroic couplet? Rhyme dynamic pentameter. Okay, heroic couplet is a traditional form of English poetry commonly used in epic and narrative poetry, consists of a rhyming pair of lines in iambic pentameter. Okay, so iambic refers, hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Iambic refers to a type of food use. I have told you there are many meters in English. If you gone through the textbook, you might have come across so many meters in English poetry, isn't it? In the first block, you can see you might have come across different types of meters, right? So anyway, the most famous meter is iambic. Iamb indicates an unstressed syllable followed by a stressed syllable. Pentameter indicates, last class we have seen there will be 5 feet. Okay. So the present one is a heroic couplet. Okay. Rhymed iambic pentameter. Most of the famous authors wrote in iambic pentameters. Epithalamic follows. See, this is the rhyming scheme. Epithalamic follows a rhyming scheme. A, B, A, B, B, C, C, D, E, D, E, F, F, and so on, except the 15th stanza. Please note it. If you have a textbook, something like that, please note the rhyming scheme. Even if you're writing essay or annotation from epithalamium, please try to include the rhyming scheme of the poem. A, B, A, B, C, C, D, E, D, E, F, F, and so on, except 15 stanza. I mean, all 23 stanzas of the epithalamium follow the rhyming scheme. A, B, A, B, C, C, D, E, D, E, F, F. Now, the rhyming scheme of the 15th stanza is a bit different. A, B, A, B, C, C, F, E, G, G, H, S. That is the rhyming scheme of the 15th stanza. Now, just a second. Yeah.
Ma'am, can you ask Minu Thomas to mute her audio? I can't hear you.
Yeah. Class, please mute your audio. Please mute.
Thank you, ma'am.
One second. So I've told you that he was the first major English poet of the Elizabethan era. Okay, from 1400 to 1550, English literature was in a dormant state. He was the major poet of the Elizabethan period, and this person has won several appellations. Okay, praises like he was known as poet's poet. Do you know in Malayalam who is known as the poet's poet? In Malayalam, we do have a poet like that. Was popularly known as poet. Can anyone tell me who's that poet? He was also a king. He was also not only a poet, but he was also a king.
Wadi Tirunal.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, so this person. Anyway, Edmund Spenser was called poet's poet by Charles Lamb. A 17th century essayist and short story writer, Charles Lamb. I think you're familiar with Charles Lamb. Then this person is also known as Prince of Poets, Mullah's Bard. And just like Shakespeare is known as the Bard of Avon, this person is known as Mullah's Bard. Mullah is a river in Ireland, okay? So Spenser had spent most of his life in Ireland. Then he's also known as Reuben of English poetry. Now, patrons of Spenser. Edmund Spenser, during those times, we need some patrons so has to support us. So has to finance us, finance poets. So the patrons of Spenser are Earl of Leicester and Sir Philip Sidney. remember these two names, patrons of Spencer. If you are preparing for NET or UGC exam, please note this name, Earl of Leicester and Sir Philip Sidney. Then he got, he married Elizabeth Boyle, to whom he has dedicated the poem, Epithalamion and collection of sonnets, Amerity. And he was buried in Westminster's Abbey. And who was the first poet to bury in a Westminster's Abbey? Do you know who's the first poet to be buried in Westminster's Abbey? It's Chaucer.
Okay.
Yeah, Edmund, Geoffrey Chaucer is the first person to bury in Poet's Corner. It's known as Poet's Corner. Yeah, Westminster's Abbey. Okay. Now, major work of Spencer. So these are the major works of Spencer. Shepherd's Calendar. So Shepherd's Calendar has got 12 eclogues. 12 eclogues stands for 12 months of a year. Now, Ferrycune is the most famous, the best known work of Shakespeare, Spencer. And it deals with the it is dedicated to Queen Elizabeth. Okay, now complain. Let me tell you, this Edmund Spencer was very ambitious. He was born in a poor family, even though all his relatives are very noble, are from noble classes. This person was very poor. Then later, this Lord Harvey introduced him to Earl of Leicester. Earl of Leicester, in turn, introduced him to his famous cousin, Sir Philip Sidney. Okay. And Philip Sidney, in turn, introduced him to the Queen Elizabeth. Okay. So, thus, he became a very favorite of Queen Elizabeth. And Queen Elizabeth had sent him to Ireland, so has to suppress Irish rebellion. Anyway, this person was being very ambitious. He suppressed Irish rebellion, and Queen Elizabeth had given him the castle of Kilcoman in Ireland. Okay, Queen Elizabeth presented him a castle in Ireland near Kilcoman. Okay, Spencer has wrote most of his famous work by living in Ireland. Then Calling Clothes Come Home Again. So Calling Clothes Come Home Again. See, even though he lived in Ireland, his heart was in England. He really wanted to come back, and he wants to get, he always wanted to get a good designation in Queen's Court. So Calling Clothes Come Home Again is all about his frustration. Then Astrophel is an elegy written at the death of Sir Philip Sidney. Astrophel is an elegy. Please remember. Amerity and Epithalamium, love sonnets, and specifically dedicated to Elizabeth Boyle. Okay, Elizabeth Boyle. Then Hymns, collection of poems. Prothalamium and spousal verse. See, Prothalamium is a pre-wedding poem. Unlike Epithalamium is a wedding poem. A marriage poem, but Prothalamion is a pre-wedding poem which was written in the honor of the double marriage of Lady Catherine and Lady Elizabeth. Okay, we will discuss this in detail. So we have seen an overview of Epithalamium. I think you got an overview about Epithalamium and the structure of Epithalamium. 24 stanza, 33 lines, 365 longer lines, 16 stanza represent the daytime, 8 represent the nighttime, and the rhyming scheme, ABAB. Yeah. ABAB, CC, DD, DE, DE, FF. So this is the first stanza of Epithalamion. I hope we can start.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, yeah. Ma'am.
Yes. One second. So anyway, Spencer's poem, Epithalamion, falls into modern English. Unlike Chaucer's Canterbury Tale falls into Middle English, this one falls into Modern English. You learn sisters which have oftentimes been to me aiding others to adorn whom you thought worthy of your graceful rhymes, that even the greatest did not greatly scorn to hear their names sung in your simple lines, but joy in their praise. And when you list your own mishap to mourn, which death or love or fortune's wreck did raise, your string could soon to sadder tenor turn and teach the woods and water to lament your doleful derriment, and now lay those sorrowful complaints aside, having all your heads with gore and crown. Help me my own lines praise to resound. Now let the same of any be inured, so I unto myself along will sing, the wood shall to me answer and my echo ring. So this is the first stanza of Epithalamion. So in this, you learn sisters which have oftentimes helped me in writing poetry. So who are those learned sisters? Actually, in the first stanza, Spenser is invoking those muses. Just like when we, great poets of India, when they have written their great works, they have always invoked God and goddesses, isn't it? In India, like I think Valmiki and Vyasa, they have invoked Lord Ganesha when they have written Mahabharata and Ramayana, isn't it? Similarly, Edmund Spenser, when he started to write Epithalamium, he first invoked muses. I hope, do you know who are the muses? Who are the nine muses of, nine muses? So nine muses, their name goes like this. Calippo, muse of epic poetry. Cleo, muse of history. Then Entropy, muse of flute. Then Melpomene, muse of tragedy. Terpsichore, muse of dancing. Urania, muse of astronomy. Thalia, comedy. Like that, we have nine muses. Okay. Anyway, this person, when he begins Epithalamium, he first invokes those learned sisters. Learned sisters are muses. So he says that this nine muses, this nine learned sisters have often helped him in writing poetry. So has to praise others. So he being a court poet, the first and foremost aim of this person is to praise, flatter other eminent people, isn't it? So this person has several times has shown his great skill in praising others whom you thought worthy of your graceful rhyme that even the greatest did not greatly scorn. So this learned sisters helped Edmund Spenser just because they knew it very well that the person whom Edmund Spenser going to praise are worthy enough to be praised. That is why they have helped him. Okay. To hear their names sung in your simple lines, but joyed in their praise. Anyway, those people, when their names being sung by Edmund Spenser, they became very happy. They are not at all annoyed, isn't it? Why they became very happy? They enjoyed it. Because they think that Edmund Spenser is skilled. And they see, the particular person hasn't mocked Edmund Spenser, but he has correctly used those words in praising them. When you list your own mishap to mourn, and which death or love or fortune wreck did raise. So this nine muses, they have not only helped Spenser in writing poems which appreciate great people or eminent people, they have also helped him in writing elegies, death poems. Okay. So they have helped, Edmund Spenser in writing both elegies and love poems. So your string could soon sadder tenor turn and teach the woods and waters to lament your doleful derriment. So when Edmund Spenser is writing some elegy or some sad poems, their string, the musical instrument suddenly changes the tune to a sadder tone. Okay, hearing the sad tune, even the woods, forest, water, echoed the same tune. Now lay those sorrowful complaints aside. Having all your heads with garland crowned, help me my own lines praise to resound. So, okay. Now this is not the time to complain or talk about someone else. If this time you should help me, having all your heads with girl and crown, help me my own lines and praise to resound. This time you have to help me. Now let the same any be anew. So I unto myself alone will sing. This time I want to sing for myself. I don't want to praise anyone, or I don't want to write an elegy. This time I'm singing for myself. What shall to me answer and my echo ring? See the last line, that is a refrain. All throughout the 24th stanza, this line is repeated. What shall to me answer and my echo ring? So have you seen the line? Which one? Now lay those sorrowful your heads crown and help me mine own line praises to resound, and now let the same of in inured, and so I unto myself alone will sing. See, he stresses the point that this time please help me to sing for myself. Why? Because there is a myth, there is a myth over there. See, let me tell you, the another feature of Epithalamium is this poem is full of mythical allusions. He has used lot of Greek mythology. That's a speciality, a medieval feature, medieval element that you can see in Epithalamion and Prothalamion. Okay. So the medieval feature or the mythology that is in the first stanza is, I think you're familiar with Orpheus. Are you familiar with Orpheus? Orpheus is a musician. He has the capacity to animate inanimate objects. He has the capacity even to move the mountains and stars. It is believed. So anyway, his wife's name is Eurydice. One day she happened to swallow a pomegranate, which was believed to be a fruit of vice. And she was poisoned and she died. And her soul was taken to underworld. Who's the king of underworld? Pluto. Who's the wife of Pluto? Somebody know who's the wife of Pluto? Pluto. Hello? Somebody over there. Hello?
I don't know, ma'am.
Yeah. Her name is, Pluto's wife's name is Persephone. Okay, Persephone. So Orpheus, being a great musician, he decided to get back his wife's soul from Pluto. He went to underworld, and first of all he convinced Persephone. Then Persephone in turn convinced her husband Pluto. Then Pluto has agreed to give the soul of his wife, but on one condition. The condition was this: see, he can take his wife's soul, she will follow him, but he should not turn back until he reaches earth. Okay, until he reaches earth, he cannot turn back. But as he was about to reach earth from underworld, as he was about to reach the earth, he had some kind of suspicion whether Persephone is still following him or has she vanished or not. Then he turned back. No sooner did he turn back than her soul disappeared. That's the story of Orpheus and Eurydice. I hope you followed it. Okay, so this is the myth that is conveyed in the first stanza. Line from, now lay those sorrowful complaint aside, and having all your heads and girl crown, help me mine own lines to praise to resound. Now let the same of any be inured, so I unto myself alone will sing. I unto myself alone will sing. Unlike Orpheus, who has sung to praise Pluto, this man doesn't want to sing for anyone. Unlike Orpheus, he's not like Orpheus to sing for someone else. He's singing for him. Okay, so that is a very summary of the first stanza, let me tell you, there are 24 stanzas, and in each stanza we have 18 to 19 lines, and it's not possible to cover all stanzas. So I'll be getting you the gist of each stanza. So I have already told you there are 24 stanza, and 24 stanza represent each hour of the day. So first stanza, we have already seen that is a invocation. In first stanza, poet invokes the muse to write a poem. In second stanza, poet appeals to muses. He asks the muse to rise early and go to the chamber of his bride. What's the name of his bride? Bride-to-be. What's the name of his bride-to-be?
Elizabeth.
Elizabeth Boyle. Okay. Because don't get confused, this person is very ambitious and very shrewd and very clever. For that reason, in Epithalamium, you can also see some reference to Queen Elizabeth. Okay, Queen Elizabeth, because every now and then he was trying to convince Queen Elizabeth, because he always wanted to get a position in Queen's Court in England. Okay, so let me tell you one more thing. He has used several mythical allusions and several metaphors. For example, Phoebe. Phoebe means moon. Okay, moon goddess. Phoebe, one is Roman version. Then Cynthia, Greek version. Okay, Cynthia, Phoebe, etc. are same name for moon goddess. Okay. So anyway, this is an indirect reference to Queen Elizabeth. You got it? Wherever he refers Cynthia, Phoebe, etc. Actually, that is an indirect reference to Queen Elizabeth. I told you, Fairy Queen is dedicated to Queen Elizabeth. Now, so he's asking the muses. In first stanza, he invoked the muses. In second stanza, he asked those muses to go to the chamber of his bride. To wake her up, because the Hymen is the god of marriage. He's already ready. Now he's going to start the procession. So he's asking those muses to go to her chamber. Now, in third stanza, poet asks the muses to bring all the beautiful girls of the country, of the riverside, forest, and to carry a basket full of flowers so as to adorn bride's chamber and her path. In fourth stanza, he says, all those muses are none but they are the nymphs of River Mulla. I told you, Mulla is a river in Ireland, a river on the boundary of Kilcoman Castle. At the beginning of the class, I have told you that Kilcoman Castle was gifted by Queen Elizabeth to Edmund Spenser for successfully suppressing Irish rebellion. So those muses brought so many beautiful girls from rivers and woods. They are none but they are the nymphs of River Mulla. And they have been asked to decorate Elizabeth Boyle's chamber and her path. Now he also invokes other songsters. Other nymphs of music, so has to celebrate his wedding day. Now, stanza number 5. Yeah. So here, he is asking his wife to get Hello. So in this fifth stanza, he's asking his wife to get up early because sun has already gone up in the sky. Now she has to get ready for the marriage. Now in the sixth stanza, upon the request of the poet, bride-to-be Elizabeth Boyle gets up. Then poet is asking the entire world to attend her. Seventh stanza, poet is asking bridesmaid and boys to attend upon him, because he and his beloved are getting ready for the marriage. And one more thing, see, the day that Edmund Spenser chooses to get married is the longest day of the year. It's the longest day of the year. And so he's asking Lord Apollo. Who's Lord Apollo? Sun god, right? Sun god. Apollo is the sun god. So he's asking Lord Apollo to make him the center figure or the presiding deity of the day. Let him take all 364 days. Okay. There are 365 days in a year, isn't it? So he's asking Lord Apollo. He's pleading Lord Apollo. Okay, you are. We know that Lord Apollo or the sun god is very handsome. Isn't it? Sun god is very handsome. It's the handsomest god. Okay. So he's asking the sun god to make him the central figure, presiding deity of the day. To make the poet the presiding deity or the central figure of the day. Why? Because all 364 days, Apollo is the central figure. But this day he wants to be the deity. Now, in stanza number 8, poet, he is accompanied by the jocund company of young men. Young men, just like bride will have so many, flower girls, and a big train will, she will be followed by a big train. Similarly, our poet is also followed by jocund company of young unmarried men. So, ninth stanza, I mean, Elizabeth Boyle comes out of her chamber. She is very beautiful. And see, she's as beautiful as Phoebe. I told you who is Phoebe. Phoebe is moon goddess. That means there is also one comparison. She is as beautiful as Queen Elizabeth. Okay. So she is dressed in white, and she is said to be the maiden queen. In 8th, 9th, 10th stanza, he is praising the physical beauty of Elizabeth Boyle. She is very shy, she is very modest, etc. And she keeps her eyes lowered because she's afraid that her gaze would meet the people. For that reason, she lowers her gaze. Now, in stanza number 10, as the bridal procession had come out of her chamber, that is Elizabeth, after grooming, Elizabeth Boyle had come out of her chamber. Now the procession is going through the street. As the procession moves, beautiful ladies, ladies of beautiful daughters of tradesmen, they came and stood over the two sides of the road so as to see the beautiful bride. Okay, those beautiful ladies are standing on the two sides of the road so as to see our beautiful Elizabeth Boyle. Okay, and in 11th stanza, he again praises and he says that she is the epitome of all feminine qualities. She is the seat of all feminine quality. Imagine if she is a shop. She is a shop of all virtue. See, a man will get whatever thing that he is looking for from a woman, from Elizabeth Boyle, a woman like Elizabeth Boyle. So in 11th stanza, there's a comparison. He compares her to a beautiful palace. Elizabeth Boyle is a beautiful palace. So every man wants to get into such a palace because he can find all kind of things that are capable of pleasing him in Elizabeth Boyle. Now the procession reaches the church and enters the premises amidst the singing, the chant. Okay, in 12th stanza, around 12 o'clock, around 12 noon, the procession, I told you, each stanza represent each hour of the day. So around 12 o'clock, the procession reached the church. Okay, so they started singing the praise of Jesus Christ. Around 1 o'clock, what happened? Having entered the church, priest has solemnized the wedding. Then, rest of the people, they were wonderstruck seeing the beauty of Elizabeth. Now, around 2 o'clock, that is 14th stanza, after the marriage, a grand party is thrown. Almost entire rustic people, they have participated. And in 15 stanza, that is around 3 o'clock, what happened? He calls upon the people of town to enjoy, to celebrate his wedding day, to dance with him. Okay, so around 16th stanza, that is around 4 o'clock. He is anxiously waiting for the evening start to come. He is anxiously waiting for his wedding night, so has to so has to unite with his wife. So far he was begging all the songsters, maids, young men, muses and nymphs, to come and dance with him, to come and help him to dress up and his bride. But around 4 o'clock, he's asking, hey, why you people are standing here? Now you may go back. I want some time with my beloved. So he's anxiously waiting. He's scolding son. Why can't he plunge into the western waves? He's waiting for moon to come. He welcomed evening star, forerunner of night, when it appears in the sky. Okay, now the in 17th stanza, around 5 o'clock, is asking dancers, beautiful ladies, to stop dancing. Come on, stop dancing, all celebrations are over. Now he is anxiously waiting for his bride, beautiful wife Elizabeth Boyle. He wants her to be with him in the chamber. So he's asking all her maids and other beautiful girls to take her to the bed, chamber. And bed is covered with soft lilies and violets. Okay, now around 6 o'clock, around 5 o'clock, he asks those damsel to take her to the chamber, right? So around 6 o'clock, he's praying before that nuptial union, before getting united or before getting consummated, before getting the marriage consummated, he's asking, again he is praying, invoking goddess, because England was politically unrest then, isn't it? England was not in good terms with France or Ireland at that time. Okay, so anytime they can expect a night attack from enemy countries. So he was praying, he was invoking God and goddesses to save him and his wife from the evils of the night. Okay, 19th stanza also, he continues the same prayer. Now, in 20th stanza, that is around 8 o'clock, when he was about to get intimated with his wife, he has seen, there is an allusion there. That chamber is beautifully decorated with curtains, Cupid chasing birds. Actually, Cupid is, I hope you know who Cupid is. Cupid is the son of Venus, goddess Venus, isn't it? I think you are familiar with that. We have a similar counterpart in Hindu mythology. Who's that? Can somebody name me?
Kamadevan.
Yes, exactly. So the chamber is beautifully decorated with curtains, where Cupid is trying to catch the bird. So here Cupid is none but, Cupid is the poet and bird is the beloved. Okay, I hope you understood. Now, in 21st stanza or around 9 o'clock, when poet is about to get intimated with his wife, somebody peeped into his room. Somebody looked into his room. Who's that? A sudden apparition. The moon has risen, and so it makes its unavoidable appearance. It's none but moon goddess. Okay. Phoebe, Cynthia, it can be anyone. So he's complaining, hey, moon goddess or Phoebe, why you are peeping into our room? Okay, why you are peeping into our room? You too have enjoyed your wedding night with Endymion. Endymion is a shepherd guy. moon goddess, the Cynthia or Phoebe, had fallen in love with shepherd guy Endymion. She too has celebrated her wedding night with Endymion. So he's asking, see, you have celebrated your wedding night with your guy, right? Why you are peeping into our chamber? And one more thing I would like to say is, see, this talks about, actually, this is an indirect reference to Queen Elizabeth. So he's afraid that this is private moments, right? So he's afraid of getting any kind of orders from Queen Elizabeth at this time. He doesn't want to take any order at this time because he, at this time, he wants to enjoy with his wife. He doesn't want to take any order from Queen Elizabeth. Then one more thing I would like to tell you is that, see, Earl of Leicester, Edmund Spenser's patron. I hope you remember when I said Edmund Spenser has two patrons, Earl of Leicester and his nephew, Sir Philip Sidney. Okay. So Earl of Leicester, he was very handsome, and it is believed that Queen Elizabeth had some kind of illicit relationship with Earl of Leicester. So there is an indirect reference in stanza number 21. Okay, 21. Now, stanza number 22, around 10 o'clock. Now he's about to enjoy. He's about to enjoy the wedding night. So he's asking blessings from Juno. Who's Juno? Wife of Jupiter. Juno is the Roman version. Okay. Zeus is the Greek version. Jove is the Roman version. Both are same. Jupiter. God Jupiter. Okay. So wife of Jupiter is Jove. Hera. Okay, Hera. Jove is Roman version. I told you Zeus is Greek version. Similarly, Hera is Greek version. Juno is Roman version. Juno is the wife of Jupiter. Okay, so he is asking blessings from Juno. Hebe is the daughter of Juno and Jove. Zeus and Hera. So Hebe is believed to be the goddess of youth. She can turn anyone, any old person, to a young man again. So she is the goddess of what? Youth. Now Juno is the goddess of fertility. Okay, goddess of fertility, childbirth and all. Okay, she is the one who blesses a young lady with fertility and all. Okay, Hymen. Hymen is the god of marriage, and he is the one who gives consent to a man and a woman for the consummation. So he's asking blessing from Juno, Hebe and Hymen. So has to bless them with fruitful progenies, kids. Now in the 24th stanza, that around 11 o'clock, he's praying all deities of the Olympus mountain. So during in Greek myth, according to Greek mythology, all Greek deities are believed to be lived at the top of Olympus mountain, just like we have Himalaya over here, isn't it? Similarly, and last 24th stanza, please note this, 24th stanza is an envoy. Unlike other stanza, see, I told you there are 18 to 19 lines in almost all stanza, except in 24th stanza. In 24th stanza, there are only 7 lines. There are only 7 lines in 24th stanza, and 24th stanza works as an envoy. So envoy means in the place of something else. Envoy means in the place of something. That means at the time of his marriage with Elizabeth Boyle, he had met with some accident, some financial issues. Owing to financial issues, he couldn't gift her anything precious. So he has written Epithalamion as a wedding gift to his wife. So he's asking Elizabeth Boyle, kindly accept my love poem, that is Epithalamion, as a wedding gift in lieu of many ornaments. Actually, he really wanted to give her precious jewels and gems. But at this time, owing to certain financial issues, pecuniary issues, he's not in a position to give her. So instead of that, please accept my love poem. So this is the very gist of Epithalamion. Now, have you understood? At least have you got an outline of Epithalamion? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, the next poem is Prothalamion. One second. Prothalamion is the next poem. I hope still you can see the slide. If there is any problem, please do inform me. I will share the slide again. So I told you, Epithalamion he wrote for himself. He wrote for his wife. But Prothalamion is a pre-wedding poem which he wrote in the honor of the wedding, a double wedding of Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine to Henry Guilford and William Peter on 18th November 1596. So Prothalamion is believed to be the swan song of Spenser. That means a death song or the last song, the last famous work of Spenser. So what is the meaning of Prothalamion? The meaning of Prothalamion is a before marriage song or a pre-wedding song. What is the meaning of Epithalamion? A bridal song or a upon the bridal chamber. Don't get confused. Okay, next. So before starting Epithalamion, let me tell you something. After the death of Earl of Leicester and Sir Philip Sidney, Spenser lost all his patrons, isn't it? But we need some patron to continue in the court. We need some patron to support us. So the next patron was Earl of Essex. Okay, Lord Essex. So Lord Essex is the father of bridegrooms Henry Guilford and William Peter. Have you understood why he has written such a poem? I already told you, Edmund Spenser was very ambitious. He was always looking for a greater existence in his life. So if he is praising someone, then he has some intention. This time he wrote Prothalamion so as to celebrate the double wedding of Lady Catherine and Lady Elizabeth to Henry Guilford and William Peter. So Lord Essex, I forgot to incorporate in the slide, but you may please note it. Lord Essex, Essex, is the father of Henry Guilford and William Peter. Okay, now let me start this poem. So this is the first stanza. Calm was the day, and through the trembling air, sweet breathing Sapphires did softly play, a gentle spirit that lightly did delay, hot Titan's beams which then did glister fair, when I, whom sullen care, through discontent of my long fruitless day, in princess court and expectation vain, of idle hopes which still do fly, which still does fly away, like empty shadows did afflict my brain, walk forth to ease my pain, along the shores of silver streaming Thames, whose rutty bank, which his river hems, was painted all with variable flowers, and all the meads adorned with dainty gems, fit to deck maidens' bowers, crowned their paramours against the bridal day, which is not long. Sweet Thames, run softly till I end my song. So this is the first stanza of Prothalamion. Let me tell you one thing. See, epithalamium is bombastic. I mean, words, allusion, mythology, everything. He has that is a poetic overflow of romantic feeling of the poet. Okay, I told you it is epithalamium is a poetic overflow of romantic feelings. But this one, compared to epithalamium, it is very smooth. Okay, it's a very smooth poem, musical poem, something which he has compiled. This poem is under control, not like a sudden outflow of romantic feeling. Epithalamium is a sudden outflow of romantic feelings. Okay, this is not like that. So in the first stanza, he says that calm was the day, and through trembling air, it was a calm day. Accompanied by west wind. Sapphire is the west wind, god of west wind. The day was very calm, accompanied by gentle blowing west wind. So west wind was blowing gently on that calm day. A gentle spirit that lightly did delay hot Titan's beams. Hot Titan is none but sun. Against sun. See, let me tell you something. Before Apollo is the sun god. Before Apollo, it was Titan, who was the sun god. We also, in Greek mythology also, there are several changes in the government, okay? Not only in the present world, but they do also have a change in the government and rule. Okay, so before sun god, it was Titan, who was the sun god. Okay, leave it. So that was a very pleasant day. West wind was blowing gently. A gentle spirit that lightly did delay hot Titan's beam, which then did glister fair. Okay. So anyway, the mildness of the day has considerably reduced the fiery rays of the sun. Anyway, the day is very calm and mild. Wind was gently blowing. Because of that, it was able to reduce sun's heat for some time. Only for some time, sun's heat was reduced. Okay. When I whom sullen care, though through discontent of my long fruitless stay in Prince's court, expectation vain, but this person is untouched by the gently blowing wind, mildness of the day. He was not at all bothered about what is going around him, because he was discontent. Why he was discontented? Because he was not at all satisfied. He was staying, see, through discontent of my long stay, fruitless stay. He was staying in Ireland, away from England. He always wanted to stay in England, but he was sent on a mission to Ireland by Elizabeth. So he stayed there expecting that he will get some position in England. So he was very much worried about that. Of idle hopes which still does fly away. So that day was very calm. Everything was going very smoothly. Even the sun's rays were also very, the intense rays of sun have been reduced by the mildness of the day. Still, the poet was not happy. He was very discontented. Yeah. Like empty shadows, this afflict my brain. Walk forth to ease my pain. So all those things has afflicted his happiness. Now he's suffering because of his frustration. So he is now walking. Walk forth to ease my pain. Now he's walking along the shore of River Thames. See, there is a slight difference in the spelling. P-A-I-N-E. It's pain. P-A-I-N. Have you seen the word P-A-Y-N-E? That is similar to P-A-I-N. Brain. B-R-A-I-N is equal to B-R-A-Y-N-E. Small difference in spelling. Okay, so this person was very much weighed down because of the frustration of not getting a position in the queen's court. So has to console himself. He was walking along the shore of River Thames. So whose rutty bank, which is River Thames, was painted all with variable flowers. Okay, so river of Thames, I mean bank of river Thames was beautifully painted. Here it is painted. I mean bank of river Thames has so many flowers. I mean covered with variable colored flowers. All the meadows adorned with dainty gems, fashionable gems. Those beautiful flowers are just like fashionable gems. Those variable colored flowers along the bank of river Thames are just like beautiful gems. Suitable enough to decorate bride's chamber and to make a crown for their paramours, for their partners. Okay. Against the bridal day, which is not long. So, when he was walking through the shore of River Thames only, he noticed those beautiful flowers that are growing on the bank. Those flowers are so beautiful as precious gems, suitable or beautiful enough to decorate a bride's chamber, a maiden's chamber, or to make a crown for their partners. So then only he remembered, okay, the wedding day is not so long. Sweet Thames, run softly till I end my song. So the last line. So in Epithalamium also we had a refrain. I hope you remember the refrain, the woodchild to me answer and my echo ring. And here the refrain is, sweet Thames, run softly till I end my song. That is the refrain used in the Prothalamian. Now, let me sum up. So unlike Epithalamium, we don't have so many stanzas in Prothalamium. We have only 10 stanzas. We have only 10 stanzas. Yeah, I hope you have got some awareness about the first stanza of Epithalamian. Yes, hello. Hello, please mute your mic. Please mute your mic. Okay. So, yeah, let's see the gist of Prothalamian. So I told you in first stanza, poet was very much poet was trying to unburden his heart by walking along the river Thames. At that moment only, he has seen some flowers growing. I mean, beautiful flowers that is growing on by the bank of river Thames. So in second stanza, while he was enjoying the beauty of flowers, he suddenly saw two damsels. I mean, damsel gathering flowers. In third stanza, he has seen two swans swimming down from the River Lee. River Lee is in Ireland, okay? So two swans are none but Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine Somerset. Okay, so I repeat, in first stanza, he's walking along the River Thames, so has to unburden his heart. Then he started to enjoy the beautiful flowers that are growing on the meadows. In second stanza, while he was enjoying the beautiful flowers, he saw some beautiful girls gathering flowers from there. In third stanza, he saw two swans swimming down from River Lee. River Lee is a river in Ireland. And the swans are none but they are Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine. Now, in fourth stanza, those nymphs who were collecting flowers from the meadows, now they hurried to see the swans that they are swimming in the River Lee. In fifth stanza, they have started to shower flowers upon the swans, and they have decorated entire path. In sixth stanza, Edmund Spenser says that Venus Cupid, he's asking Venus and Cupid to sing the song. Venus, we know, goddess of love, goddess of beauty, goddess of all kind of art forms. Cupid, goddess, god of love. So he's asking Venus and Cupid to bless Lady Catherine and Lady Elizabeth. So this, I mean, other nymphs started to sing. In stanza number 7, when one of the nymphs finished her song, other damsel or other nymph started to sing. So anyway, Lady Catherine and Lady Elizabeth, who have been represented as swans, is now they are accompanied or encircled by other fowls, birds. And he says that Lady Catherine and Lady Somers, Lady Elizabeth exceed other birds that are swimming in the River Lee, just like moon exceeds stars in beauty in the sky. There is a comparison in stanza number 7. When you read the poem, you will understand. In stanza number 7, he says that two swans are encircled. Two swans that are swimming in River Lee are encircled by other birds. See, these birds are they are nothing in front of Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine. That means other girls, other beautiful ladies are nothing when compared to the beauty of Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine. He makes an analogy, or he makes a comparison here. That is, their beauty is just like moon. Again, they're compared to Queen Elizabeth. They are just like the moon. See, in sky, at night time, you can see moon in the sky, encircled by millions of stars. Even though millions of stars are there in the sky, moon still outshines them. So the way moon outshines them, in the same way Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine outshone all other beautiful ladies. Now the nymphs, now the swans and other birds have reached London. They started their journey from Ireland. Remember, they started their journey from Ireland by swimming down through River Lee. Now they have reached London. Okay. So, in 9th stanza, he's paying a rich tribute to Lord Essex. I hope you can see the word Essex. E-S-S-E-X. Essex is none but the present patron of Edmund Spenser. Okay, he's the present patron of Edmund Spenser. So this person has several times helped Queen Elizabeth in winning many wars. Okay. So last stanza, poet says that Lord Essex, Lord Essex lives in a mansion which was occupied by Leicester. Leicester was the first patron of Edmund Spenser. Now that mansion is occupied by Lord Essex. So now we have clearly understood why this person has written such a musical poem in the marriage of Lady Elizabeth and Catherine to Henry Guilford and William Peter, because they are the sons of Lord Essex. So he and his train came out to receive two swans. At the last stanza, in the last stanza, two swans have suddenly turned to brides again, that is Lady Elizabeth and Lady Catherine. Okay, so this is the very gist of epithalamion. Okay, see, there is I told you for epithalamion and for prothalamion, he has got an intention. He has got an intention for writing those two poems. Now, so class, have you got an idea about prothalamion?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so now I'm moving on to Amorety. Amorety, sonnet number 34. It's very easy, collection of love poems. This one is also dedicated to his wife, Elizabeth Boyle. Very easy poem compared to epithalamion and prothalamion. You just have to read it once, only once. Very easy. So let's see. Like has a ship that through the ocean wide by conduct of some star doth make her way. When has a storm hath dimmed her trusty guide, out of her course doth wander far astray. So here in this poem, there are so many similes. Poet has used so many similes. So ship, please note down, ship is poet, star is the beloved. Okay, please mute your mic because I haven't incorporated notes here, only the poem. So you may please note down, ship is the poet, star is the beloved, and ocean is the problem, cloud is the difficulties and confusion. I repeat, ship is the poet. Ocean is the life, the life full of problems. Then star is Elizabeth Boyle, and cloud is the quarrels or difficulty between poet and his beloved. So let's see this poem. One second. Like as a ship that through the ocean wide by conduct of some star doth make her way. When has a storm hath dimmed her trusty guide, out of her course doth wander far astray. So I, whose star that borne with her, out of her course doth wander far astray. So in this first four lines, he says that he is a ship that is wandering through an ocean, by conduct of some star doth make her way. Actually, in ancient days, ships were guided by a pole star, isn't it? A north star. Similarly, he was guided by, so far he was guided by his wife, Elizabeth Boyle. When as a storm had dimmed her trusty gate, but some problem has occurred that has taken his wife away from him. Just like a storm takes a ship away from the pole star or the north star, he lost his way, out of a course that wander for astray. So without north star, it will be too difficult for ship to go in the correct direction in ancient days. Similarly, without Elizabeth Boyle, it is too difficult for the poet to lead a normal life. So I, whose star that born with the bright ray, me to direct the cloud is overcast, do wander now in darkness and dismay. So I, poet, whose star that born with her bright ray. So now the poet is not getting the guidance from his wife. Ship is not getting the guidance from the pole star. So it is going astray, moving without any direction. Poet is also wandering in darkness. Through hidden perils round about me placed, yet hope I well that when the storm is past, my Helios, the Lord Star of my life, will shine again. So we know that in sea there will be a lot of sandbanks, then icebergs, hidden mountains, so many hidden dangers in the sea. So if there is light in the sky, a sailor or the captain can easily spot the danger in the sea. But since it is clouded, since the sky is clouded, they cannot spot the danger. Similarly, when his wife was with him, she was able to guide him. So at that time, he was not that worried about the dangers in his life. But now he is very much worried about the dangers that have engulfed or encircled him. So, but he is very optimistic. He believes that she will come back. He believes that she will come back because she is his pole star or Lord star. And he believes that she will shine again. She will come back again after the storm. After the cloud clears, pole star, just like the pole star shines again, his wife will also come back. Yeah. Now, yes, and look on me at last with lovely light to clear my cloudy grief. Then, till then, I wander careful, comfortless, in secret sorrow and sad pensiveness. So here, he believes that she will come and make me happy. Just like when the storm clears the sky, a cloud clears the sky, moon and stars will shine again. Similarly, she will also come back and will make him happy. So until then, he will have to lead his life in sorrow and utter dismay. And so I hope you have got an awareness about this poem. Have you understood sort of number 34? Hello, have you understood?
Yes,
ma'am. Do we have this poem in our textbook?
Yes, page number 36. This is very easy. This poem is very easy.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now, next poem. Sonnet number 67. See, the rhyming scheme of this poem is slightly different because let me tell you, this poem is Edmund Spenser has written it using Spenserian stanza, but poem number 67, that is sonnet number 67, the scheme is a bit different. Rhyming scheme is ABAB, CDCD, EFEFGG. He has used Shakespearean, okay? Shakespearean rhyming scheme. Please note it. Sonnet number 67 is not written in Spenserian rhyming scheme. It is written in Shakespearean rhyming scheme. Shakespearean. I repeat the rhyming scheme. You may please note it down. ABAB, CDCD, EFEFGG. Have you got the rhyming scheme? ABAB.
Okay.
ABAB, two times ABAB, then two times CDCD, CDCD, then EF, then EFEF. EFEF.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Then GG. Then GG. Okay. So, sonnet number 67. Let me tell you, here also we have so many comparison. Huntsman. Please note down the comparison. Huntsman is the poet. Hunter is the poet. And deer is the beloved. Huntsman is the poet. Deer or the prey is prey. P-R-E-Y. Prey is the beloved. Okay, like as a huntsman after weary chase, seeing the game from him escaped away, sits down to rest him in some shady place with panting hounds beguiled of their prey. Okay, so in this first stanza, first four lines, he says that like a huntsman, poet compares himself to a hunter who is chasing his game, prey, can be a deer. So he is very tired because he has seen a poet or the hunter is very tired seeing his prey escaped from him. Now our hunter or the poet is resting under a tree with panting hounds beguiled of their prey, just like those hounds who are hunting their prey after running for a long time, you'll be panting, right? Similarly, in the same way, our poet or the hunter is also panting, seeing his prey getting away from him. So after long pursuit and vain essay, when all weary had the chase forsook. So he has been following his beloved for a long time. That means hunter has been following his prey for a long time. But poet has failed in all his attempt. Hunter has failed in all his attempt. Okay. So The gentle deer returned the self same way, thinking to quench her thirst at next brook. So after failing in all his attempt, now he is taking rest under the tree. Okay. So at that time, deer returned the self same way. I mean, the prey returned so has to drink some water from the stream, nearby stream. That means poet has been chasing his beloved for a long time. So poet now very tired. Now he's sitting under the tree. So when beloved looked back, she doesn't have anyone to follow her. See, normally girls enjoy all kind of flatter and they love men following them, isn't it? That is a normal thing. All girls or all women will enjoy the man whom they love follows them. Okay, only the man whom they love they will enjoy only those person following them. So similarly, when beloved looked back, no one is following her. So far she was very happy. Why? Because he was following her. Now when she looked back, no one is following her, so she returned. There she, beholding me with milder look, sought not to fly, fearless still did bide. So deer, that was drinking water from the stream, even though it was drinking water from the stream, actually it casted an eye upon the hunter, what he was doing, why he is not chasing me. Similarly, beloved also, what happened? Why he has given up following me? Similarly, girls will be what? Attracted or will become more attached to the person when they withdraw, isn't it? When men withdraw, when men withdraw from the pursuit, women move towards them, isn't it? That is the normal psychology, isn't it? Similarly, when he stopped chasing her, she came closer to him. She was observing him. She was observing him cleverly. What he is doing this time, but fearless still did abide. At first, she had some fear in her mind about getting married to a poet. But this time, she is totally fearless. But she is very doubtful. Should she have to give her hand to the poet? Till I in hand her yet half trembling took. And with her own goodwill, her firmly tied. So, strange thing me seemed to me, a beast so wild, so goodly, one with her own will beguiled. So, this time with a trembling look, with a half heart, she decided that, okay, I think this person is good. I can give my hand to him. So this time, without chasing his prey, without chasing the beloved, she came to the poet by herself. So far he was chasing her, but this time she came to him by herself and she handed over herself to the poet. So poet became very happy. It is better to get things at their own will, isn't it? It's better to get girls at their own will rather than forcing them. So he became so happy to win her hand. So that's a very summary of sonnet number 67. I hope there is no doubt. Is it clear? Is this sonnet clear to you? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, okay. Ma'am. Now I'm moving on to sonnet number. Sonnet number 77. One second. Let me drink some water. So Was it a dream or did I see it plain? A goodly table of pure ivory, all spread with Yukon's fate to fit to entertain the greatest prince with pompous royalty, amongst which there is, there in a silver dish did lay two golden apples of unvalued praise, for passing those which Hercules came by, for those which Atlanta did entice, exceeding sweet yet void of sinful vice, that many sought yet none could ever taste, sweet fruit of pleasure brought from paradise by love himself and his garden palace, her breast, that table was so richly spread, my thoughts the gust which would thereon have fed. Okay, this is a very interesting poem, very sensual, erotic poem. Let's see. So, was it a dream or did I see it plain? So, he is asking, he starts this poem with a question. Was it a dream? Was it a dream or a reality? A goodly table of pure ivory. He can see a table made of ivory. And that table is spread with all kind of spread which you can speak to entertain all kind of delicacies, all kind of expensive food items, so has to entertain, so has to feed the prince of great royalty. So I repeat the first four lines. One second, can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So he's asking, he started the poem with a question. He says that, he asked that whether it is a dream or reality, because he can see a table made of pure ivory. And that ivory table is spread with expensive food items. So has to entertain a great prince. Among which there is a silver dish did lay two golden apples of unvaluable price. So let me tell you, on that ivory table, what attracted the prince the most is two golden apples in a silver plate. I told you that ivory table is spread with lot of expensive food items. But what attracted our prince the most is two golden apple in a silver plate. Okay. Now, for passing those which Hercules came by, for those which Atlanta did entice, see this golden apple. Golden apple is actually found on a tree that is grown in North Africa. And it is believed to be grown by Hesperides. Hesperides is the daughter of Hesperus. Evening Star. Okay. I repeat, the golden apple is found to be is found in North Africa, and it is grown by a daughter of Evening Star. Hesperides is also a goddess. Okay. Actually, nine muses are Hesperides' daughters. Okay. When I began the poem Epithalamium, we have seen that Edmund Spenser is invoking, he invokes nine muses, right? Actually, those nine muses are the daughters of Hesperides. Okay, so this golden apple, the tree which gives golden apple is looked after by Hesperides. So Hercules, during one of his missions, he has stolen two golden apple from the tree. Okay. Or those which Atlanta did entice, exceeding sweet yet void of sinful vice, that many sought yet none could ever taste. Okay. And this is the same apple which failed Atlanta. So Atlanta is again a swift-fruited Roman princess. Okay. She hates entire mankind. She hates men. Okay. So, when her father forced her to get married, she has given her consent, but upon one condition, the man who wants to marry her should outrace her. But this lady is very famous for her swift feet. Okay. She's a swift-footed princess. So she put forward one condition, that is, if a man should marry her, then he should outrace he should outrace her. Anyway, so a person named Hippomemis, Hippomemis, he came forward. See, so many person tried their luck to marry Atalanta. They all failed and they all were executed. I mean, all those people, all those suitors who failed in their attempt to get to marry Atalanta, they are executed. Sorry. Yeah.
What is your condition?
So, I'm sorry. What was the condition put forward by Atalanta?
Yes.
Yeah, I told you she. Okay, I will start. See, or those which Atalanta did entice, exceeding the sweet yet void, sinful ways. Okay, I told you Atalanta is a Roman princess. Okay, Roman princess, she hated entire mankind. She hates men in general. Okay, men in general. So when her father forced her to get married, she put one condition in front of her father. I mean, the one if someone wants to marry her, then he should. He should outrace her. Outrace her, he should win the race. He should win the race. Got it. This actually, it is very difficult to defeat Atalanta in race. She's very fast. She's as fast as our Bolt, Usain Bolt. So this lady is too difficult to defeat. She's too difficult to defeat in a race. So many suitors came to try their luck, so has to marry her, but all of them failed in their attempt to outrace Atalanta. At last, a person named Hippomemis came. Okay, he knows that it is an impossible task. It is not possible for him, for a human being like him, to outrace, to defeat Atalanta in a race. So what he did is, he has taken golden apples from Hesperides. He has taken 3 golden apples and he started to race with her. So when at the beginning, he thrown first apple, so she was distracted. So again Atalanta overtook him. Then again he thrown the golden apple. Once they reached the last lap, at the last lap, when Atalanta was about to finish, when she was about to reach the finishing line, he has thrown the last apple. Atalanta got distracted, seeing the very beauty of the golden apple. Hippomemis overtook her and he won the race and he married Atalanta. Now, have you understood the tale?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, this golden apple is as beautiful. See, this golden apple is very beautiful enough to distract Roman princess Atalanta. And Hercules, who is a demigod, during one of his missions, he too has stolen that fruit from Hesperides. That means that fruit is that desirable, isn't it? That is why they all got distracted. We know that Atalanta, Hercules, etc. are demigods. They are demigods. Okay. Demigods means offspring of a mortal and immortal. Isn't it? Hercules' father is Zeus. Born to a earthly woman. Hercules' mother is an earthly woman and father is Zeus. So, he's a demigod. Similarly, Atalanta is also a gifted lady. Not an ordinary one. Just like Amazon warriors. Very gifted. Yeah, very gifted, very cruel, and very bold. So many people have pursued golden apple. So, what author or what poet says in these lines is that, see, those apples in the silver plate, Those apples in the silver plate are as beautiful as the golden apple reared by Goddess Hesperides. Have you got the connection? Now he is sitting in front of an ivory table spread with lot of expensive food, with many expensive food. But what attracted him the most is the golden apple in a silver plate. That golden apple has been designed by many great people like Hercules and Atlanta. Okay, so in turn he says that many sought, yet could, yet none could ever taste sweet fruit of pleasure brought from paradise. See, so many people in the history or in the past have tried to taste that fruit of pleasure by love himself and his garden pace. So love himself, Cupid himself came to taste that golden fruit, but everyone failed in their attempt to taste. Her breast, that table was so richly spread, my thought the guest, which would thereupon have fed. So what are those two golden apples on the table? Table is the very body of the beloved. Now have you understood? Table, ivory table is the ivory colored body of the beloved, and two golden apples are the boobs or the bosom of the Elizabeth Boyle. And the guest, the prince who is sitting in front of the table, was ready to devour those golden apple, relish the golden apple, is none but poet himself. Now have you understood sonnet number 77? That's why I told you the poem is very sensual and erotic. Have you understood sonnet number 77? This is very easy. Actually, Epithala,
yes, ma'am.
Block 2 is very easy, very romantic, very sensual. You can, yeah. Is there any doubt?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. One second. I'm just showing it again. If there is anything, you can ask me. So you have to incorporate all these details when you write an essay. Okay, I have incorporated almost all details, all important details of Epithalamion. So if there is no doubt, we can wind up the class. I hope you have started writing your assignment.
Ma'am, please explain us how you expect from us how to write this assignment, how it should be. These are two questions. Two lessons we have already completed. No, first two questions. Chaucer's and Edmund Spencer's questions.
You can write essay question in 4 to 5 pages. But the important thing is that you have to incorporate all points, allusions like this.
Ma'am, 4 to 5 pages only for 20 marks question.
If you have time, you can write up to 7. 7 or 8 pages. But see, it doesn't matter how many pages you write. What matters is the point that you incorporate. Yes.
I actually have one question, just a moment.
Yeah. Yes, you can ask me.
Just a moment. See, ma'am, our first assignment question is locate Chaucer's Prologue to Canterbury Tales within his vast writing career as a social commentary of the age. Okay. Ma'am, so we have to give the details of all the 29 characters.
Yes, exactly. I already told you Chaucer's Canterbury Tale is a social satire. He's ridiculing all the pettiness of people from different classes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that is a social commentary. That is why the work stood the test of time.
Ma'am, one more thing in Epithalamion, that poem. Okay, that's not coming into my mind. So the word shall, the wood shall to me answer and my echo ring. So what did you say is special about that line in the first stanza? That was a very something you said that, which was not clear to me, ma'am.
It is a refrain. Actually, the last line refrain. Refrain means that line is repeated at the end of each stanza. Throughout the 24 stanza, that line is getting repeated.
Okay.
If you check the poem, you can see that.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. So, I don't know how far you have understood the poem that I have dealt today. I hope at least you have got an outline or an overview about Epithalamium, Prothalamium and 7 poems. If you read by yourself, you will clearly understand the poem.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then I hope I can wind up the class.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. So I just wanted to check with you all guys. Do you have a separate WhatsApp group for Kochi? Can you please send the link here right now? Hello?